Thank you again for inviting me. And as Joshua said, it's the first time that we have encountered snow. So we'll enjoy it for a few days and then we'll go back home where it's nice and warm, stays warm throughout the year. And leave you with the snow. But I do realize that there are advantages and different and challenges in different environments. And you do have an advantage, I imagine, in the snow. If it melts slowly, you'll have a good spring. So hopefully that will happen this year. I'd like to start off my first talk is about the missing dimension in cattle breeding, which is inherent body condition. You see, when I talk about grazing, I've realized many years ago that we can't separate grazing from cattle, because the two go together. And what has happened over the past is that although we've been breeding cattle in the direction that we thought was right, was in the wrong direction. And I'll explain to you. So we need to breed cattle very differently in future to be able to use them to improve the land without losing too much body condition and use them to effectively, efficiently convert grass into beef. So that's what I'm going to talk about the cattle side now. So again, although we come from very different environments, as you can see there, the principles are universal. That's a tropical environment that I come from, Central Africa, where we get 40 inches of rain in a 4-month period, and then we have an 8-month dry period. No snow, no moisture, very dry. And at times before the rains start, it can get very hot. But we have a relatively mild tropical climate because of the high altitude that we live in. It's 4,000, 5,000 feet above sea level. But our biggest challenge in that environment is nutrition. And that is why body condition, inherent body condition, is so important. I apologize here. It's going to be difficult to stay away from the pillar, but I'll try and move away so you can see me every now and again. Again, environments differ. This is in Mexico, where you have people that are grazing at very high stock densities in that environment. It's a different environment. They also get snow up in the mountains. And they have this challenge also of having to graze the mountains. But through my travels, I realized that some people don't know what they can't do. And because they don't know what they can't do, they do it. Like grazing up in those mountains there. For a lot of people, it would be impossible to do. The problem is our current cattle breeding model. And I use this, bull as an example of what we've strived to breed. The problem is that because if you talk to a crop farmer, his goal is production per acre or profit per acre. If you talk to a cattle rancher, inevitably it's production per animal and not production per acre. And that is a big problem. So we have to change our thinking. We have to make that paradigm change from profit per acre or production per animal to production per acre. If that is the case, then all our breeding and management practices have to be revised. And in fact, they will probably have to be the opposite of what we're doing now. If you look at the current cattle breeding model that emanates from the United States and used all over the world, it's production, maximum production of profit per animal. And in terms of selection, we look at absolute values of performance in terms of growth, size, the faster growing animal, the larger animal, the more milk, carcass, feed conversion. It's all, unfortunately, related negatively to inherent body condition, as I'll explain a little bit later. Because body condition obviously requires fat, and fat requires much more energy to produce than lean meat. So if we're selecting for growth rate, or we're selecting for efficiency of conversion, we are invariably allowing the leaner animals to be the better performers, because there's less energy conserved in lean meat than in fat meat. But as a cow-calf producer, you require cows to go through a winter or a dry season, and the only energy reserve they have is body condition, fat. So we have to select for body condition, fat, inherent body condition. So all that is negatively correlated to inherent body condition, exactly opposite. And that's where we stand today. We've selected cattle that can be productive, but they require better nutrition in order to be productive. So they focus on detail, EPDs, what do they call them, breeding values. The problem with that is that we're using the wrong criteria. So it's the equivalent of accelerating the speed of a car on the wrong road. You'll only get to your destination much quicker. And that's exactly what you're doing with EPDs, accurate measurements of inappropriate criteria. The other thing is that we adapt the environment to suit the genotype. We produce cattle that can go fast, and they can be productive, but they require better nutrition in order to be productive. And it's all counterproductive in terms of profit per acre, because invariably we have to allow them to graze non-selectively, to choose what they want, the better nutrition, and we don't utilize our pastures to maximum productivity. In other words, the efficiency of grass conversion isn't nearly what it is. And in many environments, in particular in our environment, in the tropics, it's very simple to double your stocking rate. You can do that by just carrying more cattle. Because in an environment with poor nutrition, we allow the cattle to graze selectively, and in most circumstances, they only graze off the grass. Other, they just leave. So every now and again, in a tropical environment, you have to burn the grass. But if you can increase stock density and utilize that grass, you can double your stocking rate overnight, which was the case in my case, was that I could do that. So we graze to adapt the environment to suit the genotype, we graze selectively. Get used to these. We graze selectively, we use energy feed, and we have total parasite control. Because if you're in an environment where you have a lot of parasites, in order for the cattle to increase the intake, you have to control the parasites. Although we do have cattle that are resistant, genetically resistant to parasites. But we've never done that. In my situation, we for over a century now, we've been dipping cattle through plunge dips to control the ticks. All we've done over that period of time is not breed tick-resistant cattle, but poison-resistant ticks. And the problem is it just aggravated. We started using arsenic about 70, 80 years ago. Then we moved to other poisons, and we're still changing it all the time as the ticks become resistant to the particular dip or poison that we're using. So we have to change it. We have to breed tick parasite-resistant cattle. Now, if you look at that animal there, that is the epitome of what they had in the past. That was a show winner. I think the only thing going for Mr. Fluffy Tail is that he's probably, in today's political climate, he's probably politically correct in the sense that he's not totally white. He's not very masculine. And he's probably not very straight either. So that's the only thing going for him. I just want to see if anyone's paying attention, so I can see. Okay, the consequences of that cattle breeding model is that we breed cattle that are nutritionally unadapted, as this bull you see here. To many of you, it might be a good-looking bull, but I breed that bull, and I know that that type of genotype, although they are large animals and they grow fast, they're the first ones, from the cow point of view, that won't reconceive because they can't put on body condition easily. And the other thing is because of the selective grazing at low impact, we have environmental degradation, as you see there, the consequences of that. In this environment, what you see there are rivers that in the past, 100 years ago, had clear water running throughout the year. Now what you have there, you have a drought and a flood within one season. You have a drought because you have a flood, there's nothing keeping the water back. And you have a flood, it results in a drought, and then you have a flood again. So it's a perpetuating situation where the environment degrades all the time. So we have to change that totally. So the best that modern scientific breeding has done is to breed cattle that require expensive inputs in the form of feed and chemicals in order to be productive. That's all we've done. We haven't bred cattle that are more profitable or more efficient grass converters. It's the contrary, we've bred cattle that are less efficient in terms of converting grass. And they're less efficient because they also have poorer body condition, which we have to alleviate by allowing them to graze more selectively and by feeding energy supplements. So why are the unimproved breeds superior to the scientifically improved breeds in range tests in Africa, for instance? They talk about the scientifically improved breeds, where they select them according to weight gain, feed conversion efficiency. But if you take those breeds and you compare them to the unimproved native breeds, African breeds, that have been under tribal situation, those breeds are far more productive in range tests, where they measure production in terms of productivity per unit of land. And just by looking at fertility, in a drought situation where they compared three different breeds, the Nguni there would be your African breed, the African tribal breed, your Bonsmara, which is a scientifically improved breed, and your Simmental, and that is the calving rates in a dry year. You can see there very clearly. And the reason, there's only one reason for that, it's a very simple reason, and that is that these breeds here have had to survive over many years of natural selection, but also aggravated natural selection. Aggravated in the sense that the tribal people put more pressure on them by corralling them at night and part of the day, and they only have 4 to 5 hours of grazing time. So what you have there in those breeds are animals that have survived a very short period of grazing. In other words, those animals that now are the survivors had to go out and graze as much as possible. And there's a very important link between, if you look at all the African breeds, and you look at all the tropical breeds that have developed under natural selection, they're all small frame. And the reason being is that small frame cattle have an unfair advantage. I'll explain that later. And large frame cattle are genetically handicapped. And that is all to do with intake. Not absolute intake, but relative intake. Relative intake is a term I've coined over the past years when I started understanding what was happening. And I'll explain that a little bit later. So the common denominator of all these animals is cross conversion efficiency, a small frame, and inherently high body condition, as you see in those breeds there. This is an African breed in Africa, and that's an African breed in the United States, in Texas. If you look at the land there, that's central Texas, and look how it has degraded. All those animals that have to graze there are weeds. There's no more grass. So the only way forward for the current model is to develop twinning. If we carry on with the current model of cattle breeding and management, we have to look to our professors at university to help us produce twins every single year and raise those twins without any problems. That is the only other way, if we carry on with the current model of breeding. But luckily, we do have another option, and that is to change our goal in terms of outlook, in terms of not for production per animal, but production per hectare. If we do that, to increase our stocking rate is very simple. Rather than twinning, we can double our stocking rate. So that is a much easier option, and that is what I'd like to talk to you about. Are there any questions, maybe, quickly, or comments? I'm a little bit limited in time, but I'll take questions. Yes, sir.
Could you explain what BELD is?
Range.
Okay.
It's a term we use in Africa. It's a term I'm very comfortable with. It's actually more than just the range. It encompasses more than that. It's the climate, everything, felt. Animals out in the open range, prairie range.
You were talking about parasite control, you know, as a genetic factor. Is that by breed or just by inherent genetics in those cattle?
Well, it's both breed, would be genetic, and also individuals within the breeds. So what you will find is if we do start selecting, we'll find that certain animals within any breed genotype, some animals will be far more resistant than others. But we've never followed that option because it was much easier for us just to use chemicals to control ticks and internal parasites. But we have to get away from that. We can't go in that route. Apart from the fact that it's more expensive, it's also environmentally degrading. We're killing a lot of beneficial insects like our dung beetles by using dips and by chemically treating internal parasites. So we have to get away from that completely. Any other questions? Okay, so what we're going to talk about now is the goal of maximum sustainable profit per acre. And that is very different. It requires different management and breeding practices to the current model, which has a goal of maximum production per animal. So it's sustainable in the sense that it's economically sustainable, but it's also ecologically, has to be ecologically sustainable. If we have to do that, then we realize that cattle actually have a dual role. They've been created with a dual role. One, from our point of view, is that they have to be efficient grass converters. They have to make us money. And the other one is that we have to use those same cattle to improve the land, as you see there. That's a stock density of about 1,200 animals per acre. But again, I have to emphasize what I'm going to talk about now might sound a lot dogmatic to you. I have to emphasize that environments do differ. I'm talking about high stock densities. I'm talking about high animal impact. But the impact in stock density that you require here will be very, very different to what I require in the tropics because of different soils, different vegetation. But it will still be have to be much higher than what we are accustomed to in conventional management. But it just shows what can be done. I mean, I've been up to stock densities of 5,000, 2,000 animals per acre. It was required in my environment, and I could do it. So we just have to find a management system that makes it easier or practical for you to be able to do that. And I believe it is. The big problem is that our minds are the problem, to make a mind shift. Our minds, the human mind is an enigma. It's either very creative or the same mind can be an obstacle to progress. How many times have you heard that, yes, you can do it there in Africa, but not here? Or if you're in Africa, you can do it in the United States, but you can't do it here in Africa. It's all about the mind, so we have to change that. Stocking rate is by far the most important determinant of profit. Even if you doubled your stocking rate and you decreased your production per unit of animal, you are still going to make much more money. And you're going to improve the environment if you manage correctly. So stocking rate is by far the most important. If it wasn't the case, and we went back to the older model, then we'd have to be able to produce twins, which would just be a nightmare. It's not possible to do it. It's much easier to increase our stocking rate. And to double your stocking rate, I think in any environment is achievable within anyone's reach. But I would go as far as to say in certain environments, you could probably quadruple the stocking rate. I tripled my stocking rate over 7 years, and I could probably have quadrupled it if I still had the land, still managing the land after 7 years. But doubling is very simple, it's very easy. So that is by far the most important, even if we have a lower production per animal. They did the trial in Zimbabwe in the 1970s where they doubled stocking rate because the grass was available. They doubled the number of animals and they made smaller paddocks. Not enough, but smaller. And they, although the calving rate dropped from 80% to 67%, weaning weight dropped by 10% at double stocking rate. At double stocking rate, the profit was still 28% higher. But that, I'm not content with just doubling stocking rate and a drop in performance. I want to double stocking rate or treble it and still have a higher performance per animal. But that will come from inherently higher body condition. Smaller animals, more animals, and that will be able to. So the ideal situation would be to double your stocking rate or treble it and also treble your profit or double your profit. That is achievable. But then we have to change the genotype and we have to change management to a certain degree as well. And fertility, obviously, is the most important trait required by cattle for profit. So fertility is very important. So if we can double our stocking rate and increase our fertility by better inherent body condition, by changing our production cycle to be in sync with nature, in other words, calving at the wrong time, which is the right time. I know some of you calving in June, which is wrong, but that's the right time. Because conventionally, I'm sure you calve much earlier than that, do you? What's the conventional calving time here? Most people. Sorry? Now, what's the logic in our minds when we do that? It's a bigger calf. That's the only reason. Why do you want a bigger calf? Because you want production per animal. But we don't see the bigger picture. So it's true. So we have to change quite a few number of things. This situation you see is one of ranchers I've been advising in Mexico. He's changed his calving season like you've done here, and he's come down to a six-week breeding season, calving season, which can be applied anywhere in the world where you ranch. You just have to calve at a different time. And maybe change your genetics a little bit, and maybe fine-tune your rumen supplementation. When I talk about supplementation, I'm not talking about high levels of feeding. I'm just talking about keeping rumen microbes active so the grass can be digested efficiently. So non-selective grazing, which I advocate, if we want to increase our stocking rates, which is the most important determinant of profit, we have to graze non-selectively as well. And non-selective grazing requires the requirement for high stocking rate and cow fertility is influenced by body condition. Just think a little bit about that. If we graze non-selectively, we will influence body condition. And fertility is also influenced by body condition. So inherent body condition, coupled with management changes that positively affect body condition, will have a positive influence on fertility. And if we increase non-selectivity of grazing, our stocking rate, and we increase our fertility or maintain a high fertility, we'll get a very high return on our capital investment, which is land, which I assume is quite high, and also the profit per acre will be much higher. So everything in cattle breeding and management revolves around body condition. Everything revolves around body condition. Think about it. If your cows are in good body condition, there's a good chance they will reconceive. If they're poor body condition, they won't reconceive. If you want to sell a carcass, it has to be good body condition. We have a choice. Cattlemen have a choice. Breed or feed for good body condition. We can't get away from the fact that we require good body condition, but we have a choice. We can breed for it, or we can feed for it, or we have a combination of breeding and, to a certain degree, feeding. But the option to breed for better body condition is a much better option because it impacts positively on our profit per acre. But currently, again, the route we've taken, the breeding model, the current breeding model, is negative against body condition. If you look at we're breeding cattle for the feedlot. Do the feedlot cattle people want fat cattle or do they want lean cattle? Obviously, they want lean cattle, otherwise they wouldn't have a feedlot. So that's exactly what we're doing. And you hear a lot of people saying, I'm talking about South Africa, for instance, which also follows the American model of feedlots, etc. You talk to a cow calf operator and he says, but I have to feed what the feedlot wants. Okay, you can do that. But what about your cows? Then you have to feed your cows as well. So if you look at the bigger picture, where are you going to make more profit? By breeding cattle that fit into a feedlot situation or by breeding cattle that fit into a range situation, which can also be fed if necessary. The feedlot can also use those cattle and feed them, but they will feed them for a much shorter period of time. And if they're background, then we're going to make much more money anyway. So the route we want to take is a win-win for everyone. Win-win situation. But if you go the feedlot route, we're losing out and the feedlots are winning. So feedlot cattle or grass cattle? Any questions? So inherent body condition is the basis for sustainable profit. And you see it in those animals, an African zebu here. Look at them, they, through natural selection, they have inherent body condition. And this is an animal in Oklahoma in the United States, which is a cross between Angus and the Mashona. Mashona is an African breed that is very similar to the Angus in terms of color. It's black, if you want black cattle, and it's polled as well. So it combines very well with the Angus. If you have Angus Mashona cross, the only difference you can see is that the cross has better body condition, and they're more smoother coated. They will grow a longer coat in winter, but they'll be smoother coated in summer. And if you're in the Midwest, Missouri, Oklahoma, and further south and southeast, we have humid summers and hot summers. And this is something I never realized until I visited the United States. I come from a tropical environment. I never see heat stress cattle there because we're all adapted. I come to the United States, and all I see in the Midwest in summer are heat stress cattle because your cattle aren't adapted to the summer heat. And the problem is, I think, that because of the big difference between summer and winter, cold winters and hot summers, people have overreacted and thought that they, by using European breeds, they could overcome the winters. Yes, you can. But what about the summer? If the cattle aren't putting on body condition in the summer, which they won't be doing if they're heat stressed, you still have a problem with winter adaptation. So I think body condition, although coat is also important for cold adaptation, I think we've underestimated the importance of body condition. So we have to select for that. In your northern, more northern climates here that you have here, I would just select the European breeds, but select them for animals that are smooth coated in the summer, which is also a good indication of overall health, immune system, hormonal balance, and let them grow coats in winter as long as they can shed those coats in summer. I know that every single one of you, your herds, you have extremely good cattle. Let's take a top 10% of your cows. In your individual herds, the top 10% of your cows are extremely good. Would you agree with me? You have cows that are extremely good. I know that, even if you don't disagree with me. I've seen it. I've traveled quite a bit and I've seen it. Every single herd, you will have that. But the question is now, the bulls you're using, do they complement your best cows or not? Just think about that for a moment. Where do you get your bulls from? Do you breed your own bulls or do you buy bulls? Are the bulls you're using, do they complement the top 10% of your cows or not? And I think that's the case is it's not the case. In other words, they might improve their bottom 10%, but the top, your better cows, if you don't have an extremely good bull that complements them, their progeny will be poorer genetically than what they are. So the challenge now is to identify bulls that complement your best cows. And in this case here, I've given this example. This is in Africa again. You have an adapted animal here, same breed, similar breed to that. But this is a very poor example. If you're a cattleman, you know that a bull that looks like that, that's slab-sided, he doesn't have body condition, doesn't have good body condition. You need an animal that complements the body condition of this animal here. And the following side, you will have that. Same cow, if you have a bull like that, it will complement those cows. So that is a challenge. And without changing your genotype, you'll never reach the ultimate in terms of what you can produce per acre or profit. It's extremely important to change your genotype as well. And inherent body condition must be addressed through bull selection, as I said. Now, what you have here, which is very interesting to me anyway, this is a tropically adapted breed. It's a zebu from Africa. And here you have a temperate adapted breed. It's a breed. It's a bull that a photograph was taken in Wyoming. It's a breed you're probably not familiar with. It comes from France. It's called an Aubrac, A-U-B-R-A-C. But just look at the outline, disregarding this animal's hump. You have exactly the same outline there. So all productive, adapted animals have the same form. The only difference being is that this animal is tropically adapted and this one is adapted to the temperate climates. But the intake size ratio is very high. That is why they look like that. That's why they have such good body condition. That is why they have that form. Tight sheath, roundness. It's all related to that. That'll be the common denominator. Common denominator would be an inherent body condition, good inherent body condition. So inherent body condition, grass conversion efficiency is the same thing. What's related is dependent on four factors. One is frame size, climatic adaptation, parasite, disease resistance, and individual appetite. That is what determines body condition. Frame size. If you look If you look at all the mammals in the world, just think for a moment. Your biggest animal would be your elephant and your rhino. Your smallest mammals would be mice. Which animals have the highest intake, absolute intake? Obviously, your elephant. Elephant takes in about 300 or 400 pounds of herbage, grass, leaves, twigs, bark a day. Your mouse has a very low intake. But which animal has the highest relative intake? Relative intake being intake relative to its size. The elephant takes in 200 or 300 pounds, but it weighs a couple of tons. The mouse will take in a few grams, but it also weighs a few grams. So would you agree with me that your mouse has got a much larger relative intake? If that is the case, how does that reflect in body condition? You have two animals of the same size, and one has a larger intake than the other one. Obviously, it's got more nutrients above maintenance available for production. And eventually, those nutrients will end up going into body condition. So your smaller frame animals, as I said, have an unfair advantage. The fact that they have it's a biological fact, that their intake is much higher. Relative intake is much higher than that. So their body condition will be much higher. Give you an example. You can look at this in my book if you want to look at it into detail. If you have a cow that weighs 1,400 pounds, which I think a lot of cows do weigh that and probably close to that, you take another cow that weighs 700 pounds. I haven't seen many of them. That's half the size. Now, the 1,400-pound cow, on average, will have a 67% higher intake of grass, not 100% higher. It requires a 100% higher intake, but only has a 67% higher intake. Relative intake, your smaller animal, will have a 20% higher relative intake, intake relative to the size. So it's got a 20% better body condition. Now, 20% better body condition is on any scale of 1 to 5 or 1 to 10 makes a very big difference. And relatively small changes in body condition at a certain level will determine whether a cow is pregnant, reconceives, or doesn't reconceive. And remember, a cow isn't 50% pregnant. She's either 0% pregnant or 100% pregnant. So a small difference in body condition will push you over that threshold whether she'll be pregnant or she won't be pregnant. So it's very important to understand that. It's just a small difference. So that's why I say your smaller frame animals have an unfair advantage, and your larger animals are genetically handicapped. How are we going for time? How long do I have?
30.
Okay. So that frame size is very important. I'm not suggesting we should select for smaller frame cattle, although if I had to give you a blanket advice, I'd say your cattle are too big. Most of our cattle are too big. But if we select for efficient cattle, they will be smaller framed. There's no doubt about that. So we do require smaller framed cattle. But when I say small, I don't mean lightweight cattle. They will be smaller in terms of their height or frame, but they'll be much heavier relative to the larger cattle in terms of size. So what that means is the body will have a different shape. The package will be fuller. So smaller frame cattle will be much rounder and fuller, as opposed to large cattle. Climatic adaptation is very important. Your winters, it's important that they're climatic adapted, or you manage them so they don't lose too much body heat. Parasite disease resistance, I don't know whether that's a big problem here. I'm sure there are challenges. And then appetite. Appetite is a very important one. You can have two animals that are exactly the same frame size, or equally adapted in terms of parasites and climate, but the one animal has a much higher intake than the other one. And that animal with a higher intake is going to be far more efficient. A lot of people don't understand that. If I had to ask the question in this room here, you have two cows, one eats much more than the other one, which is more efficient? A lot of people say the one that eats more is less efficient. It's not the case. That feed above maintenance must go somewhere. It's not just dissipated into fresh air. It goes into production, to growth, to milk production, and eventually into body condition. So the animal with a higher intake relative to the size will always be better body condition. And inherent body condition is extremely important for us. They did an experiment in New Zealand where they took identical dairy twins. This was in the 1950s. Took identical dairy twins, and they measured their intake by a rumen fistula, how much grass they were taking in. And they saw the difference between a group of twins, two identical twins, was between 1 and 2% difference in intake. And the difference between the same size animals, different twins, groups of twins, went up to 40%. And then they looked at what the reason was for that. And they saw the animals with a high intake graze for a longer period, not the 8-hour figure that we given in textbooks, but they grazed for a much longer period, and they grazed much more aggressively. And you'll have those animals in your herd. You see, at the end of the day, they're full like us, like barrels. And inevitably, they will be smaller framed as well. In your herds, which of your cows, generally speaking, your very large cows or your smaller cows, will be better body condition? It's a question. The smaller cows, I'm just looking around. I think everyone agrees with that. There is variation. Obviously, some cows can be small for the wrong reasons, and some cows may be larger for the right reasons. But when I'm talking about small and large, I'm talking about frame, not weight. So your smaller frame cattle will be lighter, but relative to the size, the frame size, they're much heavier because they have a higher intake. So we have to get growth into perspective, because everyone's using growth rate, average daily gain, size, weaning weight, yearling weight as a measurement criteria for performance testing, for performance recording, or comparing animals in terms of growth rate. Okay, but if you have my book, I'll explain that better in the book. The fastest gaining animal is not necessarily the most efficient animal. If you've got a group of 100 bulls and you put them in a growth test, is the fastest gaining bull or the heaviest bull, would he be the most efficient? Not necessarily. Okay. So there's a relationship between efficiency and growth rate, or rather, there's a relationship between growth rate and size in terms of efficiency. And that relationship is 100%. The correlation is 100%. To be equally efficient, animals of varying size need to grow in proportion to their size. What that means is, in that group of contemporary bulls, that 100 bulls that you have, that are more or less the same age, to be equally efficient, they would have to have grown in proportion to the size. In other words, if your smallest animal is 30% smaller than your large animal in terms of frame, the large animal has to be 30% heavier. Remember that. But can it eat 30% more? No, it can't. Because the larger it is, the less it eats in relation to its size. And that is why I say large frame cattle are genetically handicapped. Although the requirement for growth, for efficiency, is relative to growth, the growth has to be in proportion to size. So if you have an animal that's 50% larger, it has to weigh or grow 50% faster than the other animal. But it can't eat 50% more. And that is why they are genetically handicapped. They cannot do it. So the most efficient animal is the one that grows fastest relative to its size. Now, I want to simplify this for you. We can use measurement figures to be able to determine that. But if I say that the most efficient animal is the one that grows fastest relative to its size, visually, what do you think that animal would look like in that group of 100 bulls? You can identify it by eye. If they had the same treatment, what would the most efficient animal, regardless of its size, look like, form-wise?
Round.
Exactly, yes. I give the analogy of a package of sugar. You have a 10-pound package of sugar. It's much bigger than a 5-pound, but you've got 9 pounds of beef in that package, or sugar in that package. So 9 pounds in a 10-pound package will look relatively loose. But you have a 5-pound package of sugar. It's got 8 pounds stuffed into that package. It'll look very different. And 8 pounds and five is far more efficient than 9 and 10. And that's exactly the same. So that's a simple way of looking at it. So relative intake, relative gain determines grass conversion efficiency and body condition. I told you about the elephant. elephant takes in much more, but relative to its size, it's very inefficient because it physically can't take in enough to compare with the intake of the relative intake of a mouse or a rabbit or sheep. Look at sheep and cattle. Look at the difference. Look at the difference in reproduction rate, gestation period, sheep and cattle. That's because of the intake. A sheep has got a much higher intake, 4-5%, 6% maybe of body weight, whereas a cow might be 2-3%. Although the cow takes in more grass, but the relative intake is much less. So it's a biological fact that relative intake and body condition decrease with an increase in frame size. So small frame cattle have an unfair advantage, and large frame cattle are genetically handicapped. They're just genetically handicapped. It's a biological fact. We can't change that. But we can change our attitudes and we can change our perceptions. Visual indicator of grass conversion efficiency, an 8-5 package on the left and a 9-10 package on the right. And I have to tell you, unfortunately, that that bull on the right-hand side is a photograph I took in the United States where they were selling semen from that bull. That photograph was taken at the AI center. Now, if you had a bone meal factory or a leather factory, you're making shoes and coats, you probably have value for a bull like that. But if you're producing beef, he has absolutely no value. Imagine his female progeny. How difficult it would be to survive, never mind put on body condition and calve every year on range. Wouldn't be possible. But we can take a measurement. If you want to be more accurate, if I was breeding bulls as I was a bull breeder in the past, I can give you very accurate measurements. Because if you have 100 bulls, the obvious, the most efficient one or two or three bulls will stand out. But you'll still have a variation there. And if you wanted to measure that variation, there's one way of doing it. And that is by the 12-month hip height measurement. If you take a 12-month hip height measurement of a contemporary group of cattle, I've got tables that I've adapted from the Missouri frame score tables, and we're going to use those tables to breed different cattle to what they used them initially for. Those tables initially were to breed bigger cattle, leaner cattle. We do the opposite now. But we use those tables to determine at 12 months by hip height measurement the mature size, frame size of any particular animal. So if we do that, you can look at these graphs here which I've developed. What you find here on the left-hand side is predicted mature frame size in kilograms. You can do that from those tables. At the bottom, you have your hip height measurement, and these are the ages of the animals, 6, 7, 8 months, 11, 12, 13 months. If we're looking at 12-month measurements, let's take this bull here, number 27. He's 13 months old, so we go to that graph there. His hip height measurement, which you've taken, was 134, and that equates there, across there, 1,000 kilogram mature size. Let's take another bull here at the bottom, number 100. He was 11 months old, 113. So we go to the 11-month table, 113. And across here from that, we determine that his mature frame size is 750 kilograms at that particular age, at 12 months of age. So we know what his frame size is going to be. So what we do now, we weigh them at 12 months. There's the 12-month weight adjusted for age. That's a mature size. We divide the one into the other. We get this figure here, 12-month maturity. So this bull here, he weighs 305 kilograms. This one here weighs 300. He's 30% mature. This bull here weighs 295, which is a little bit less, but he's 39. He's nearly 40% mature. This is an example. So which bull, the one that's 30% mature or 39% mature, is going to... will have the better body condition? 39, obviously, because they're full of package. Relative to his size, he's going much faster. So we can do that, and we can rank them in terms of maturity score here. So growth and efficiency measurements currently used, age, weight, feed conversion efficiency in South Africa, relative feed intake, net feed efficiency, are all inappropriate because they are negatively correlated to inherent body condition. Cattle are being bred that require better nutrition in order to be productive. Now, why do I say that efficiency measurement, feed conversion efficiency, for instance, this one here, which they do in South Africa with the Bonsmara breed, they put animals into a confined area feed them for 100 days, same feed. They measure each individual animal's feed intake by having a transponder around its neck here. So they, each animal, they can measure its feed intake per day. So over a period of 100 days, a certain animal is taken and a ton of feed. And for that ton of feed, he's given a feed conversion of 1:5. 200 kilograms for a ton of feed, 1:5 conversion. So a bull that's 1:5, in other words, only requires 5 pounds per pound of gain. Another bull requires 6 pounds of feed per pound of gain. Which is the more efficient bull in this measurement? The one that requires 5 pounds per pound or the one that requires 6 pounds per pound? 5 pounds. In this measurement, that's his case. But is that true? If you have animals of different maturity, different fat content at the start of that feeding period, which you will have, some animals will be larger frame, some will be small frame. The small frame animals will be putting on, per pound of gain, there'll be much more fat in that pound of gain. Can you understand that? In a late maturing animal that's lean, per pound of gain is more lean meat and less fat in that pound of gain. Does everyone agree with that? You understand? Now, it's a fact that a pound of fat has got much more energy stored in it than a pound of lean meat, and per pound of gain, fat requires much more energy than a lean animal. So what you're doing by doing that measurement, you're comparing apples with pears. You're comparing in terms of weight gain, yes, the one animal looks more efficient, but if you looked at the stored energy in that one animal as opposed to the other one, there'd be a big difference. So one animal is storing energy at the expense of pounds of gain, but that energy is for later use. If it's a cow, it goes through the winter, it goes through a dry season, it requires that energy to survive. So that's what we've been doing. We think we're very clever by doing that measurement, but it's very stupid. If you really think about it, we are selecting animals that are so-called more efficient because they lean. Okay, now if you had a feed dot, that would be good. But what about your cow-calf operator? That bull has to go and produce you females that have to survive on the range. If they have that good feed conversion efficiency in that feedlot, or in this situation here, that's related to negatively correlated body condition, you're going to, a lean bull will produce lean cows. It doesn't take much imagination to understand that one. And lean cows won't reconceive. So that's a dilemma we have. So we have to change it completely by using different criteria, using maturity rate, as I said, 12-month maturity, as opposed to 12-month weight or gain, average daily gain. The only appropriate measure is relative gain or relative size, the visual package, or the 12-month maturity, as you see there. Okay, so 12-month maturity is positively correlated to inherent body condition. It's positively correlated to grass conversion efficiency, by definition. Drought tolerance, because it's got more fat stored energy. Practical fertility. What determines fertility? What are the two factors that determine whether a cow is going to calve or not? One's hormonal balance, and the other one's body condition. And this is positively correlated to body condition, so it'll be positively correlated to practical fertility. It'll have an effective immune system. They did a trial in the United States here several years ago where they looked at the body condition of cows at calving and took the progeny through the feedlot, the one on, depending on body condition. The cows that calved in good body condition, their calves had 1/5 the chance of developing a disease in the feedlot as opposed to the cows that calved in March that had 5 times more chance of developing a disease in the feedlot, because of the high colostrum value of a cow in good body condition. So when we start working with nature and we start getting all our production cycles in sync with nature, everything that happens, it will be positive. I'm sorry that I have to go very fast, otherwise I won't finish. So it's also effective immune system and also hormonal balance. Hormonal balance meaning that a bull that matures sexually earlier will have a shorter hip height, So you'll affect, it'll be a positive correlation there, as opposed to like you saw Mr. Fluffy Tail that stood about 6.5 feet, 7 feet tall. Fertility, all of you that have been through academic through university, like I did, what do they tell you at university? Is fertility highly heritable or lowly heritable? Very lowly, 8% at the highest. Now tell me, how can a survival trait like fertility be lowly heritable in nature? It's impossible. Fertility is extremely highly heritable because fertility is determined by two factors. One is hormonal balance, which is highly heritable, and it's also determined by body condition. Now, body condition is either from genetics or it's from feeding or it's from a combination of both. So if you measure fertility where body condition comes from management, feeding, then it's going to be lowly heritable. Because grain isn't heritable. The body condition from grain isn't heritable. It's only heritable if it's inherent. Does everyone understand that? So the problem is that the criteria we've used to measure fertility in the past have not been genetically discerning. In other words, the variation we have between animals has been confused by environment, by feeding, by date of calving. Cow calving in March and cow calving in June are going to have very different intercalving periods. Now, is that heritable or is it environment? It's environment. So in our measurements, we have to find a measurement that's genetically discerning. In other words, the variation between animals is largely due to genetics as opposed to environment. How does the conventional world, cattle breeding world, how do they measure fertility? What measurement is there for fertility? We hear about EPDs for growth rate, for size, for milk. What about fertility? Do you know one accurate measurement of fertility? I don't. But everyone says fertility is lowly heritable. But every stud breeder will tell you he selects for fertility. How does he do that? Not being honest. But fertility is extremely highly heritable. Let me give you a quick example. This is in our environment. I've talked about a dry period here. You can calve in the dry period, which is conventional with us. In our environment, the advice is that you calve 2 months before the rainy season starts, before the rains start, before the green flush of green grass. 2 months before. Okay, so if you calve here, this will be your intercalving period. Intercalving period, is the period between two calvings. Is anyone familiar with that? If you've got two calving dates, the period between those intercalving period. So the longer the intercalving period is, that should indicate poorer fertility. The shorter the intercalving period is, should indicate higher fertility. Have I confused you now, or do you all agree with me? Simple. If a cow calves this year on a certain date, and she calves next year on the same date, she's got an intercalving period of 365. If she calves a month later, it's 395. So surely intercalving period should give us an indication of fertility. The shorter, the better. Okay. So this is intercalving period here. And this would be your equivalent of March probably here. And here it'll probably be your equivalent of June. This is what I'm guessing would happen. Let's say that this cow, this line here, which I've drawn here, I'll explain that later. This cow here, number B, has got an intercalving period of 405 days. And I've worked out her fertility as index is 100. She's 100 because she's on that line. You've got this cow that's below the line, that cow above the line. So this one's more fertile because I'm comparing at the certain calving date. Because I know in an environment, you can't compare a cow calving here with a cow calving there unless you correct for this decrease in intercalving period, which is attributable to nutrition. Green grass. Okay, so you have a cow here, B, she's average, she's got an intercalving period of 405. You have another cow here, E, she's also average, her intercalving period is 325 days. Now, if you didn't do that correction, 405 days and 325, which is the most fertile cow? 325, obviously, but they're exactly the same. It's just the fact is that they're calving in different environments. If you had a cow calving in March, where it's more difficult, the same cow calved in June, she'd have a much shorter intercalving period. So the two things that are very important from this is that we can determine which is the best period to calve. If we calve here, 80 to 90% of your cows will be cycling before your breeding season starts. Some cows will be on their third cycle. If you calve here, it wouldn't be the case. That's why here you need a 3 or 4 month calving period. Here you only need a 6 week calving period. The other one is that you can actually determine for each individual cow, you can work out an index for fertility by comparing the cow, the intercalving period she has relative to the average. I have to carry on. I see some. If you just get the idea, maybe it'll help.
Do you have that information in your book?
It's in the book, yes. This is from the book, yeah. Okay. It's very simple. It might be difficult for you to understand now, but it's extremely simple. If what I'm talking about here now is not simple, then I wouldn't be standing here talking to you about it. Cows born within 6 weeks, there you have an example. This is in Mexico. I had over 80% of my cows were cycling when I changed my breeding season, were cycling before the breeding season started. I inseminated for 11 days, and I inseminated 80% of the cows within 11 days, every single year. So that's another advantage you have by having a short breeding season. Am I running out of time, Joshua?
No, you're good.
Okay. Non-selective grazing is a requirement for grass improvement and maximum grass utilization. Okay, that's a requirement. But the consequence is lower nutrient intake and poorer body condition. That is a fact. We can't get away from that. People that say to you intensive grazing aids cattle performance and nutrition, it's not true. But what we have to do, there's certain mitigating factors in terms of management that can make this drop lower, and also through breeding. So we have to understand its effect, that if we force our cattle to graze non-selectively, their body condition will drop, and their performance will drop. Now we have to, even with that drop, you're still going to make more money, because you have a much higher stocking rate. But I'm not content with making a little bit more money. I want to make double the amount of money. So if I double my stocking rate, I want to have double the production as well. So a requisite of non-selective grazing is a fat genotype. And that is what I like to see, a cow with that body condition, with calves this size. Calves over 50% their own weight, 60% their own weight. But these are small frame cows. They can do it. A small frame cow will produce a much higher percentage of her own calf weaning weight than a large frame cow because of intake. Fat is not a dirty word. Fat plus hormones equals fertility. Cattlemen should promote and celebrate fat cattle. Let's talk about fat cattle. Here's an example of fat cow and calf. Remember, this is an 8 month dry season that these cattle have to go through as well. So they've inherently, through natural selection and aggravated natural selection, they've been able to conserve a lot of their nutrients that are taken in terms of body condition to allow them to go through that. And that'll be very important for you during your cold winters here, is body condition. Fat calf, fat bull. That's a fat bull, that's the Aubrac I was talking about. And I would suggest that you take a little bit more interest in these animals. And Paul at the back there, who's promoting my book, will be able to help you. I can honestly say that of all the cattle I've seen in the United States, there's one herd that to me stood out, and this herd of Aubrac cattle. It's a breed that comes from southern France that apparently was raised by monks, and they were never fed grain in their whole existence. Come from mountains and rough pasture, and that is why they've developed like that. A fat Angus bull, early maturing fat bulls. Fat bull, that's not an 8 and 5, that's probably about a 9 and 5, a 9 and 4 package. But that's even better. A fat cow, but she's not only just fat, she's also producing. That's important to distinguish between a fat cow that's not producing milk and stays fat than one that produces enough milk and also produces has good body condition. It's extremely important. And I would say about 50% calf-cow weight would be about optimum. If you go much more than that, I've had cows 70%, 75%, they just have too much milk. If a cow's got too much milk, then she requires denutrition. But if you have 50%, around about 50% at weaning, it's very easy for that female, that heifer, to achieve, to be able to breed her as a yearling, 12, 15 months. It doesn't take much to get up to 60%.
Are you talking at 6 months weaning, or?
I'm talking about 7, 8 months, but if you wean at 6 months, you get 45% or 50%. That's extremely good. I'm just cautioning that one mustn't have too much milk in your cattle as well.
That's why I was curious. Yeah. The time frame of weaning.
Yeah. Yeah, when I talk about weaning, it's normally 7, 8 months. Fat cow and calf. Yearling Angus. 29 out of 30 heifers were pregnant from him. Unimproved European breeds. You also have unimproved European breeds. This is a British white. And inherent body condition, again, a reflection of grass conversion efficiency. It's the most important component of practical fertility, immune system booster, a drought reserve, and is an essential requirement of non-selective grazing. Inherent body condition is the A to Z of cattle breeding and management. Everything revolves around body condition. And if we are serious, we have to implement non-selective grazing, and we have to produce a fat genotype. Now, I was talking a little bit earlier about where do you get your bulls from? Do you breed your own bulls? Do you buy bulls from other people? Are you happy with where you buy your bulls from? Is there a similar environment to where they're going to breed in? Is everyone happy with the bulls you buy? Everyone's happy, so... Okay. I wasn't happy, so I bred my own bulls. And I bred my own composite. I initially, in 1975, I imported Lassiter Beef Master semen from the United States, and then I bred a Beef Master that was very well adapted as much as I could to our conditions. And then I realized I had to change him by using African breeds to improve the body condition. And that's what I did. So what you see here is a combination of early maturing Beef Master and African genetics, and the same with this cow here. And everyone says to you, most people say to you, you can't use crossbred bulls. Is that correct? Do you have a problem with using crossbred bulls?
No.
Good. Because this is the result. So don't let anyone tell you can't use crossbred bulls, that it won't be true. That's not true. What's very important is that if you want to breed a composite, you make the right combinations. So complementarity is much more important than hybrid vigor. If you're using two different breeds, they still have to be more or less the same type. Thank you.